Dearly Father, Lord, thank you for everyone who could come today. Thank you, Lord, for this another wonderful, beautiful Sunday that we can have together to worship you, to sing praises to you, to learn your word, and just to be together, fellowship with one another, be united as the Church of Christ. And just pray, Lord, that today you would always be with us, always speak to us, always watch over us, Lord, and bless our lives as we strive to become your children, become perfect in every way as you are perfect, Lord, and just enable us to be good witnesses of your love in this world that is constantly failing. And just pray all this in the name of Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Everyone, please stand. Our first song for today is God of Wonders.
Lord of heaven and earth.
Church that we have. Thank you, Lord, for providing this place for us, and for just giving us so much, Lord. We don't have to be always in constant fear of war. We don't always have to be in fear of not having the next meal. Lord, we have plenty, Lord, and you have given it to us. That we may testify to the world of your goodness, of your greatness, and of your blessings, Lord. And I just pray, Lord, that we would recognize just how much you have done for us, Lord, both in this world and in the world to come. I pray all this in the name of Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. All right, welcome back to our weekly Sunday message. We're going to start today the same way we do it every single Sunday with a review of what we talked about last week. Last time, if you remember, our story was a nice way to kind of tie up much of the story that we had been covering since the start of 1 Samuel. We were beginning, as we saw, what we would call a transition. With the start of this book, now we were still technically within the time of the judges. Eli was considered a judge because he was judging the people. Samuel is essentially a judge. But we see that the Israelites were still spiritually confused. Their high priests were engaging in sexual immorality, following in the rituals of pagans. And the people also felt like it was totally okay to just be worshiping as many idols as they want. Of course, with one hand still clinging to their God. This is what we saw in the book of Judges. And it persists here. They still wouldn't give up their idols. But then they went to war against the Philistines. And they lost. And that's nothing new, right? We saw that in the book of Judges. We saw that huge cycle going on. They turn to idols, they get conquered, they turn back to God, they get saved. But this time, God gave them a scare. They didn't just lose the battle, like they always lose. They also lost the Ark of the Covenant, which was a first for their nation, as we talked about. Never before had they lost the Ark. The Ark has always been with them, and it's always like a sign of God's grace, in spite of the fact that they have been unfaithful. You know, regardless of all that they went through in the book of Judges, the Ark was always there with them. No matter how far they had fallen, the glory of God was still with them. Losing the Ark dealt a heavy psychological blow. It finally hit them. This was serious. They thought they had run out of their chances. Of course, their fears were unfounded because the Ark came back not long after. But this made them realize that they really needed to make things right if they wanted to live. They really needed to change something. So they talked to Samuel, and Samuel told them to throw away their idols in order to come back to God. And so they listened to Samuel. And they did that. They gathered together. What we saw is they assembled. And when they assembled, the Philistines thought, oh, look, an easy target. All the Israelites in one place. Time to finish them off. But God stepped in once again to save the Israelites. And there was peace with Samuel as their judge. But Samuel cannot judge them forever. And that's where our story will lead us today. For this message, we're going to be looking at the book of 1 Samuel, chapter 8. And we'll begin by reading the first three verses. It reads, "When Samuel grew old, he appointed his sons as Israel's leaders. The name of his firstborn was Joel, and the name of his second was Abijah. And they served at Beersheba. But his sons did not follow his ways. They turned aside after dishonest gain and accepted bribes and perverted justice." It's not what you want to see, but this is the reality of things, right? This is the sad reality. Samuel was a great judge. He was a prophet who had good communication with God. He talked to God. God told him what needed to be done, and he did it. The people had peace when he was a judge, and they were guided in the ways of the Lord. But Samuel cannot live forever. He's only human. Everyone has to grow old eventually. Everyone has to die someday. And Samuel was getting old. It was about time for him to retire. He did something that was not exactly the best decision, but it was an easier one. You know, rather than scouring high and low, for some suitable leader for Israel, rather than trying to, you know, run some tests and have exams and train apprentices, he appointed his own sons to be leaders. That's how things went, right? And that's how we expect them to go, especially during ancient times. Their children would always follow in the footsteps of their fathers. And since they were his sons, maybe he thought he had raised them well. Maybe he thought he understood their way of thinking, knew what they were thinking. But something was wrong. Regardless of his intentions, regardless of his earnest desires, his sons did not follow his ways. Just as we saw with Eli, he could not keep his sons from turning aside, so Samuel also failed to prevent his own sons from turning aside. These sons were not righteous followers of God. They were filled with greed. They went after what they said, dishonest gain. They accepted bribes, not the sign of a good leader, right? They were corrupted. Even if you had wonderful, righteous, God-fearing parents, you can still turn aside. Even if you grew up in a great school or a wonderful church, you can still turn aside. Not everyone will accept God, nor will they heed the words of God, and such is the case here. Samuel was a great leader. His sons, on the other hand, were corrupt. What were they to do now? Verses 4 and 5. So all the elders of Israel gathered together and came to Samuel at Ramah. They said to him, "You are old and your sons do not follow your ways. Now appoint a king to lead us, such as all the other nations have." So, everyone knows that Samuel's sons are up to no good. This is no secret. This is not a thing that people turn a blind eye to. This is not something that people kind of just ignored or didn't really understand. Everyone knew. So all the leaders, they gathered to Samuel to tell him that their sons are not going to be good leaders. This is not going to work out. And they know he probably doesn't have that much time left. They tell him straight to his face, "You are old." Okay, you know, that's kind of rude, but it's also the truth. He's old, maybe not fit to lead them for much longer. His sons are no good. And it looks like he hasn't really explored other options, tried to find someone else to a suitable leader to take his place. Then what do they tell him? They have a solution. Appoint a king to lead us. Now that is quite a leap. Normally, what do you think would make more sense? I mean, if his sons are no good, then maybe they could just find someone else to take his place. They could have just asked him to appoint a new judge to lead over them. I mean, they've always had judges. It's been the way for a long time now, right? We've seen maybe hundreds of years of leadership through Moses, through the other judges. And some of them may not have been very good. We talked about that, how kind of morally they were falling apart. But for the most part, the judges still did fine. They brought peace. And on top of this, we could look at this as maybe they could, rather than try to just find random people, rather than having God specifically try to raise up judges, maybe they can properly pick judges to lead them. Instead, they specifically demand a king. And what is their main reason for wanting a king? Is it because they feel it's necessary? No. Is it because they feel it's smart or wise or sensible? No. The only reason they want a king is because all the other nations have one. Let's find out what Samuel's reply is by reading verses 6 through 9. But when they said, "Give us a king to lead us," this pleased Samuel. So he prayed to the Lord, and the Lord told him, "Listen to all that the people are saying to you. It is not you they have rejected, but they have rejected me as their king, as they have done from the day I brought them up out of Egypt until this day, forsaking me and serving other gods. So they are doing to you." So here we see that Samuel has a problem with what they said. God has a problem with what they said. There is a problem. They already have a king. Why appoint another one? That king was God, and they rejected him. If they were to ask for another judge, ask for another kind of leader, ask for another spiritual leader to take them, to take control, to lead them, to guide them, to lead them in the ways of the Lord, everything would have been fine. But they didn't want that. They wanted what everyone else had. They wanted a king. Samuel warns them, goes on to tell them, these people, about what they are asking for. They are asking for a dictator. This king is going to have the power to take whatever he wants by force. This king has the power to just raise taxes and create taxes however he wants. This king will have the power to just force people to do whatever jobs he wants them to do. They don't really have a choice. When the king states everything is a decree, then they have to listen. He will be a mere man with absolute authority over their lives to do whatever he wants. And this is going to be trouble for them. I actually find this kind of amazing, right? I mean, all the way back in the Old Testament, this, especially this part, this is thousands of years ago, way before the New Testament. God tells his people, kings, you know what? They are a bad idea. He warns them about the dangers of a human king. There's a reason why today we have presidents instead of kings, and why most people in this country have not fled the country after a change of power in our election. Can you imagine Donald Trump as king instead of president, where he can just do whatever he wants and say whatever he wants, and he can do and whatever he says will just happen? Right now, he has all these restrictions. He has to create these things, and then they have to go through Congress, and he doesn't have absolute power. The president has a lot of power, but he's not a king. It took many, many years for the human race to realize that dictators, emperors, kings are not a good idea. God warned us. But we just have to learn the hard way. The Israelites had it so good in the past, but they didn't understand it at all. They squandered the grace of God. Regardless, such is the way of God, to let us see with our own eyes the consequences for our own choices. He warns us before we make bad decisions, but he doesn't always stop us from making them. And so God gives them a king. He says, let them have what they want, because they have already rejected me. Let's read 1 Samuel 12, 13 to 19. This is a few chapters ahead. Now here is the king you have chosen, the one you have asked for. See, the Lord has set a king over you. If you fear the Lord and serve and obey him and do not rebel against his commands, and if both you and the king who reigns over you follow the Lord your God, good. But if you do not obey the Lord, and if you rebel against his commands, his hand will be against you, as it was against your ancestors. Now then, stand still and see this great thing the Lord is about to do before your eyes. Is it not wheat harvest now? I will call on the Lord to send thunder and rain, and you will realize what an evil thing you did in the eyes of the Lord when you asked for a king. Then Samuel called upon the Lord. And that same day, the Lord sent thunder and rain, so all the people stood in awe of the Lord and of Samuel. The people all said to Samuel, pray to the Lord, your God, for your servants, so that we will not die. For we have added to all our other sins the evil of asking for a king. Of course, we had to skip quite a lot of reading, a few chapters worth. But hopefully this is going to be enough to get the point across. Samuel anoints Saul as their next king, as their first king. And throughout history, you know, we see that change in leadership, always a celebration, right? Whenever a king takes the throne, whenever a president takes the office, it's a celebration, things to celebrate, people to gather around, and songs and trumpets and everything. But certainly, that's not what happens here. This is no celebration. This is a solemn affair. Before we reach this point, Samuel explains to them their history, because apparently they must have forgotten all the suffering they had endured as a people. The Lord saved them from the hand of the king of Egypt. When they turned away from God, they fell into the hands of the king of Moab. Then over and over again, all these kings came to take control over them. But God rescued them every time through the judges. And now they want a king of their own. I suppose you can call this irony. It was the kings of the nations of the earth that caused them to suffer as much as they did. And it was the suffering that caused them to want a king just like those other nations. God revealed himself to them. And it was then that they realized that what they did was evil. God would still be watching over him. As it says, you know, if you do good, God will still protect you. God will still bless you. The covenant promises were still in effect. But now they had an extra burden, the control of a king. They had to listen to everything that the king would say. And if the king was bad, he could just make them turn away from God entirely. So a simple lesson, you know, we can learn from these Israelites is that it's just not always good to follow the crowd. That has always been the case and will continue to be the case moving forward, especially as we draw ever nearer to the end of the world. There will always be trends that society latches onto, and most of them are not going to be against the Bible. And so, you know, it's just easy to get swept in the flow and follow everyone else, right? That song is popular, so you might listen to it. That YouTube video is trending, so you might watch it. That item, like those fidget spinners a while back, they're selling like crazy, so you just buy it, right? You may not be crazy for all these things. You may not even like them. You might not even care about them anymore. But for whatever reason, at that moment, at that time, you got swept away by the prevailing waves of thoughts of society. They just get to you. And as long as they don't go against the Bible, it's fine, right? But that is not always the case. You know, sometimes these trends, they can be in direct opposition to the Word of God. Sometimes these trends can be harmful to our body or to our soul. I remember a long time ago when Ouija boards were popular. I assume you all know about Ouija boards, right? They're the boards with all the letters, and you move the things around to see what the words speak. And the idea is that, of course, realistically, you're trying to communicate with demons to tell you answers. I know they still sell these Ouija boards as like board games in stores. Hasbro, the maker of board games, makes some Ouija boards, right? So, you know, people still buy them, people still use them. But there was a time when it was sort of like a trend, a fad, to really buy and use them in high school. And those things, they can be dangerous. Now, obviously, they don't have power in and of themselves, but it's what they encourage you to do that makes them dangerous. They ask you to call upon the voice of demons. And, of course, most people, they might not really believe in demons, but the demons don't care about that, right? If you ask the demons to speak to you, they might actually try to speak to you. And I've seen pastors talk about demonic possession cases where Ouija boards were involved. It opens up the gateway, opens up the doorway, gives them a chance. If you're willing spiritually to open up to them, they will be willing to spiritually communicate with you and maybe even take over your life. So sometimes trends can go against what the Bible teaches. Of course, it's up to us to study the Bible, to know what is right and wrong in God's sight. And we must be careful about the trends and influences. Just like we saw in this story, right? The Israelites, they saw that everyone had a king. So they thought, oh, it must be a good idea. If everyone else is doing it, we should do it too. But that was just a trend. Nowadays, you'd be hard-pressed to find a country that would rather have some sort of all-powerful king or dictator over them, right? The countries that today that have these kind of dictators, rulers, they're not doing all too well. Venezuela, South Korea, you don't really want to be...
North Korea?
I mean, yes, North Korea. You don't want to be in those kinds of regions, right? So just because everyone else does it, you know, doesn't make it right. So let's keep in step with the Word of God as the trends of this world catch people up in them. May we come to truly understand what is right and wrong in God's sight and follow this path of righteousness. Let's end in a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you so much, Lord, for all that you do in our lives. Thank you, Lord, for just your word that you have given us, that we may follow, that we may know the truth of the gospel, know the truth of this, the circumstances that we were born in, the state of this world, Lord. A lot of people like to complain and point the finger at people and just say, you know, there are some people that are bad, but we know the Bible teaches that we're all bad. We can't just single people out. We can't just assume that that we can overcome our state, because we can't, not all by our own power, Lord. We are sinful creatures. We are sinful beings, Lord, and we are here before you. And I just pray, Lord, that you would cleanse our hearts, cleanse our minds in Christ Jesus, and enable us to pursue you wholeheartedly. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
How great is our God?